Turn with me to Matthew's Gospel, please. And we're going to read chapter 1, beginning with verse 18. Laura Duell, I just see you out there. Laura Duell has shingles, and she's here today. How are you feeling?
As long as I'm not moving, I'm okay.
Okay, still.
Yes.
Beginning with verse 18. This is how the birth of Jesus Christ came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph, but before they came together, she was found to be with child through the Holy Spirit. Because Joseph, her husband, was a righteous man and did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he had in mind to divorce her quietly. But after he considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins." All of this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet: "The virgin will be with child and will give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel." Everybody say that together. Emmanuel, which means God with us. When Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him and took Mary home as his wife. But he had no union with her until she gave birth to a son, and he gave him the name Jesus. Thanks be to God for the reading and hearing of this, his holy word. Let us pray. Holy God, you are so good. And this story is an amazing story, and it touches our hearts so very, very profoundly. Open our hearts now for the next moments as we meditate upon this holy word, that you would give us a new truth from a very familiar piece of scripture that we might hold dear in our hearts today. We praise you and we love you. So it was Christmas time again. It was time for all of the children to get ready for their parts in the pageant. And there was one little boy in the class who desperately wanted to play the part of Joseph. When the day finally came that the teacher handed out the parts, he was sad because the part that he wanted so bad went to another boy who happened to be his rival. And the part that the teacher handed him was the innkeeper part. He was so bummed, and all throughout all of the rehearsals, he thought what he could do to get back at his rival who got to be Joseph instead of him. He thought and he thought, and he devised a plan. All through the rehearsals, he said all of his lines perfectly. But on the night of the performance, when Mary and Joseph stood outside of the inn, and Joseph knocked at the door and said his line perfectly, "May I have a room, please?" The innkeeper opened the door and said, "Sure, come on in. You can have the best room in the house." Joseph stood there for a minute, trying to figure out what he was going to do. And then finally, after a long pause, he looked back and he looked forth and he goes, "Are you kidding? This place is a dump. Come on, Mary, we're going to stay in the barn." Today we look at the character of Joseph, and of all the characters in the Christmas pageant, Joseph is the most quiet one in all the plays. How many of you ever remember Joseph having a line other than, "Knock, knock, knock, we need a room"? He doesn't have a whole lot of lines, does he? And my goodness, not only is it the hardest, one of the most difficult parts to play because there's not as much action there as there are in some of the other characters, but he has a plan in his mind, the real character, Joseph. He has a plan for how things are going to go, and his whole world got turned upside down. As I was trying to imagine this week what Joseph must have felt like, during all of this stuff that happened, I was trying to imagine his emotion, his hurt, maybe. his fears. And as I was thinking about that, yesterday I opened my email and there was this video. And it's called Holy Moly. You can look it up on YouTube and watch the whole thing. But I just want to play a little clip of Holy Moly for you. At the vision of an angel, because Joseph saw an angel too. His story has an angel in it as well. But the response of the, can you imagine? And maybe you really can imagine. Because maybe you've made some plans and things aren't working out quite the way you thought they would. How are things going for you? I mean, you've made a list, you're checking it twice, you've decorated, you're baking cookies, you're buying gifts, you're out in the hectic travel shopping areas. Oh my gracious, it's crazy. And I get out and all that, and I think about all the pressure of all those things, and the emotion that I think about is, and then just when you think you have everything planned and everything completed, and finally, it's time for the silent night, just what we sing from our holy night. All is comfortable, there is everything but calm in your Christmas. Because just when you think you have it all planned, things get turned upside down. This is our sixth Christmas at Wesley Chapel. Our first Christmas here, 6 years ago, on Christmas Eve, we were so excited to have our first Christmas with Wesley Chapel. And my folks were coming, and Maurice's folks were coming. Even Maurice's mom was coming, and she hadn't been here to the church. We moved here in July, and she hadn't been to see the church yet. And so we were excited that she was going to be here on Christmas Eve, and she was going to share that time with us. You remember that Christmas, the Smith Center was being built, but it wasn't quite finished yet, so we weren't worshiping out here yet. And the sanctuary is where we worshiped that year. And Christmas Eve is a time when we have a lot of people in worship. And that year we had a lot of people, and so we had two worship services. And at our early service, any of you remember that Christmas? It was the last Christmas we worshiped in the sanctuary on Christmas Eve. We had so many people there that year. We had chairs, double chairs up and down the aisle. We had people standing. We had people in both sides on the loft areas. It was packed for that service. And we had a beautiful time of worship together. And then we had a little break between services, about an hour or so, and Maurice's mom and dad got here, and Maurice was so excited. He was showing his mom around the church. And she had some back problems, so she was in one of those motorized wheelchairs, so she could scoot herself all over the place. And he was scooting around with her, and he said, "Now, Mom, as we get ready to go into the worship service, it might be crowded. If it's like the first service, there may be chairs up and down the aisle. So if that's the case, you know, you may just want to stay in the back of the church, and Michelle and I will come serve you communion when the time comes for communion." Well, as it turned out, that service wasn't quite as crowded, and so we didn't have to have chairs up and down the aisle. And I remember, if we were in the sanctuary, Maurice's mom was sitting right next to the back row, out in the aisle with her wheelchair, and Maurice stood right beside her the whole entire time. They shared a hymnal, and I enjoyed watching that. It was a beautiful time. And at some point, I saw Maurice bend over and whisper to his mother, and what I learned later that he was saying to her was, "Mom, since it's not so many people here, if you want to go down for communion, that would be cool, that would be okay." And she said, "Are you sure?" And I'm watching this, I'm watching her look up at him, and they're having this conversation, and he says, "Yeah, I'm sure." And so while I'm in the middle of the liturgy for the great Thanksgiving, good communion literature, I've got my hands literally up in the air and behind the communion table, and out of my peripheral vision, I see Maurice's mom coming down the aisle, and I'm going, in my mind, I'm trying to stay focused on what's happening, and I'm going, "What is she doing?" Because she wasn't always known to be a woman that you could anticipate exactly what she was going to do, and sometimes the shock factor was part of her plan. And so I'm like, "What is she coming to testify? What is she going to do?" So she rolled, and she got to like where Andy and Joy are, and she stopped right there and folded her hands and put them in her lap. And she waited until I finished saying the communion liturgy. And And then Maurice helped me serve communion that night, and she was the first one to receive communion. And as I bent over to hand her the bread, she grabbed me by the back of my neck and pulled me down and gave me a big kiss and told me that she loved me. And same thing with Maurice. He bent down with the communion cup to offer her the wine, and she grabbed him by the back of the neck and pulled him down and gave him a big kiss. And it was a beautiful night of worship. At the end of that worship service, I was greeting people at the back door, and Maurice's mom said, "I'm not feeling too good." She was really hot. She's like, "I need to just get outside and get some air." And she got outside and she said, "I think I need to go to the hospital. I'm not feeling good." And so Maurice and his dad got her in the car, and before she even got out of the neighborhood here, she died. She died on Christmas Eve. That was totally not in our plans. And in hindsight, when we look back at that night, we think, well, you know, what a go. You know, from the Lord's table to the Lord's arm, just like that, wow, what a way to go. But at the same time, everything was turned upside down. We had a whole house full of people, family and friends, and Amelia. We left the door unlocked so they could get in if they got there before we did from church. We had plans with his mom and dad the next day, and my family the next day, and so many things that everything was turned upside down. And all of a sudden, we felt a little bit like what Joseph might have felt. Ah! But not in a funny way. And oh my goodness, I thought I had control over this, but I really don't. Joseph, we're told in the scripture, was betrothed to Mary. Some of your versions might. Did anybody's version say engaged? They were engaged to be married. So betrothed, engaged. We need to understand, and I remind you of this every year, but I'm going to do it one more time, that the betrothal was different than what we think about as an engagement. It really was a binding agreement between two people. It was a legal agreement that they had made to each other. There would have been a year-long time frame of being engaged to one another. And the only way to get out of that engagement was to be divorced. And so imagine with all the plans that Joseph had made in his mind and in his heart. You know, maybe his family had planned for a long time on who his wife would be. Maybe it was an arranged marriage. We're not told that. That was customary at that time. We're not told exactly, but we know that he must have had plans and thoughts and had feelings for Mary and plans for what their life would look like together. And then she told him. She told him this story. I'm sure he wanted to believe her, but it sounded so strange. What do you mean you are with child? What do you mean? How can that be? What do you mean this child is from the Holy Spirit? How can that be? And as much as he wanted to believe in her, certainly in the back of his mind were questions over whether she had been faithful or unfaithful to him. And so in his confusion and his thinking and his processing and trying to figure out what he was going to do, he decided that he would divorce her quietly. Scripture tells us that Joseph was a righteous man. And so, as a righteous man, he would have known the law backwards and frontwards. And he knew that the law had some stipulations for unwed pregnant teenagers, which is what Mary was. And there were two choices. He could have her publicly stoned, or he could divorce her. With the feelings that he had for her and not wanting to disgrace her in public, he decided to divorce her. And that's when the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream. When he said to Joseph, "Don't be afraid to take Mary. This is fulfilling God's plan. You're going to have a son, and your job will be to raise him. And you'll call him Jesus." It fulfills the prophecy from the Old Testament that says a virgin shall conceive from the Holy Spirit and give birth to a son, and his name shall be called Emmanuel, God with us. Joseph's life was turned upside down. Mary's life was turned upside down. The government was oppressing the people. There were censuses being taken. There were things going on in their life that were not what they planned. And in the midst of all of that confusion and frustration comes Emmanuel. The hope of God when there is no hope. The comfort and peace when there is no comfort and no peace. I think some of us can probably imagine, or maybe today you don't even have to imagine. You know that you have the need in your life right now for the comfort, the presence of God Almighty. Here's what I want to tell you. In the midst of the frustration because things aren't working the way you planned, in the midst of the struggle about how you're going to be family together, how things are changing for you, how maybe someone's not in your household who's supposed to be there, in the midst of all of those things, here's the word of hope. Emmanuel comes to us in the midst of all of that. And so not just in Christmas, but in every day, we have the hope. We have a hope for a peace that passes all understanding. We have the hope for comfort. We have the hope for healing. We have the hope for an ever after. Because God is with us. Today, I invite you to open your hearts. Open your hearts to that good news. That no matter what has gone on, no matter what is going on, or maybe your Christmas is already perfect, it will happen that way for some. Even in the midst of the perfect, Emmanuel comes. Today, open your heart for Christ Jesus. Open your heart for Him to be your comfort, your peace, your guard, your guide, your friend, whatever it is that you need, because that's what Emmanuel is. I love the scripture from the Old Testament when God is calling Moses to go and redeem His people out of bondage in Egypt. And Moses has this wonderful question, and he says, "Well, who shall I say is sending me?" And God says, "I am." And we know that the word in the Hebrew language for I am is Yahweh. And what that means, and God doesn't say an answer to that question or an answer to our questions, who shall be there for me? The I am means that if you need a comforter, God, I am, is the comforter. It means if you need a healer, God, I am, is the healer. If your family is stressed over something, or about the pace, or about the worry, if you're stressing with anything, God is the I am to all of those questions. He is the answer. Will you let Him be your answer today? Let us pray. Thank you, God, that you had a plan. Yours is way better than ours. Because we have plans too. And we have our hearts and minds set on how we think things ought to go. And that's not always what happens. And God, you know us so well. You know that we like to be in control. Today, God, we pray that you would help us as individuals in this room right at this very moment to let go of the need for control in our lives. Because if we're controlling our lives, you are not controlling our lives. And if I ask each and every person in this room, do you want God to have control in your life? They would tell me yes. But sometimes the actions that I see are not answering yes. In my own life, God, I know today that there are for Joseph and Mary 2,000 or more years ago, there was no way. And you made a way for them through your Son, Jesus Christ. Today, make a way in our lives and in our hearts. Let us receive your Son, Jesus Christ. Thank you, God. We praise you. We love you. We honor you. Thank you, God. Amen. We're going to sing God Bless You, Mary Gentlemen. And, you know,